Penguin Random House Audio presents Playing with Fire, the 1968 Election and the Transformation of American Politics. This is the author, Lawrence O'Donnell. For Elizabeth. Seizing the Moment. Richard Nixon was in a makeup chair when he met Roger Ailes. Maybe it was the makeup chair that set Ailes off. He was looking at the man who might have been president now if he had just sat in the makeup chair CBS offered him in Chicago before the first televised presidential debate in American history. Nixon had ignored the network's makeup artist and used a drugstore product called Lazy Shave to cover his heavy 5 o'clock shadow. Nixon once said, "I can shave within 30 seconds before I go on television and still have a beard." The day after the debate, the Chicago Daily News ran the headline, "Was Nixon Sabotaged by TV Makeup Artists?" Richard Daley, the all-powerful Democratic mayor of Chicago, said, "My God, they've embalmed him before he even died." Nixon lost the election to John F. Kennedy by 0.2% of the vote. 49.7% to 49.5%. In an election that close, every mistake matters. A mistake like not getting the makeup right was the kind of thing that infuriated Ailes. Now, 7 years later, Ailes was meeting Nixon for the first time in the makeup room of the Mike Douglas Show. At age 26, Ailes looked like an assistant, but he was the boss, the executive producer of the show. And Nixon was once again a presidential candidate in what was beginning to look like a crowded field coveting the 1968 Republican nomination. Ailes wanted Nixon to be president, and he knew the most powerful force blocking Nixon's path to the White House was television. To win the White House in the 1960s, you had to understand and respect the power of television. Ailes knew that one of Nixon's potential rivals for the Republican nomination understood everything about television, Ronald Reagan, the former film and TV actor. Ailes wondered what Nixon had learned about TV since the makeup disaster of the 1960 campaign. Sitting in the makeup chair, Nixon offhandedly mentioned to Ailes how silly it felt to try to reach voters by appearing on an afternoon talk show like this one instead of a news show like Meet the Press. The Mike Douglas Show was targeted at housewives and usually populated by B-list showbiz celebrities. In response, Ailes instantly rattled off a list of every bad move Nixon had ever made on TV. It was a long list. Ailes was a teenager when he had seen some of these things. This was not the way people talked to former Vice President Richard Milhouse Nixon. There was none of the deference Nixon had been accustomed to for decades, and he loved it. Nixon made Ailes an offer he couldn't refuse. Instead of trying to make Mike Douglas America's biggest afternoon TV star, make Richard Nixon America's next president. With Ailes on the media team, the Nixon campaign was ready to make the move from being the worst TV campaign to the best. "We're going to build this whole campaign around television," Nixon told his media team. "You boys just tell me what to do and I'll do it." Roger Ailes' career in Republican politics, which included every day he ran Fox News, turned out to be longer than Richard Nixon's. Ailes became more influential in Republican politics than Nixon ever was. We have reason to wonder who would be president today if Richard Nixon had not provoked Roger Ailes in the Mike Douglas Show makeup room. Such are the seeds that were planted in American politics in the 1968 presidential campaign. Run, Bobby, Run. Bobby was a natural on television. In 1967, he was the only potential presidential candidate who could charm a TV audience just by being himself. All he needed was his smile. Bobby was the Elvis of American politics, the only politician who didn't need a last name to identify him. But his last name was everything. It was Bobby Kennedy's last name that made every potential candidate fear him. As the field of candidates began to take shape in 1967, every campaign calculation depended on Bobby, even when he showed no signs of wanting to run, even when he told people he wasn't going to run. President Lyndon Baines Johnson feared Bobby to the point of obsession. Johnson thought Bobby was the only one who could do the unthinkable, challenge the incumbent president's grip on the Democratic nomination. Johnson was sure that Bobby was the only Democrat who might dare to run against him. He was wrong. Nixon feared Bobby too, as did every Republican planning a campaign. Nixon knew exactly what to fear. He had lost to a Kennedy before. Losing to a Kennedy meant losing to the Kennedy political machine, and it meant losing to the Kennedy style. A political machine can be beaten by a better political machine, though Nixon had never seen a better political machine than the Kennedys. Kennedy's style was something else. Nixon knew there was nothing else could do for his image that could compete with Kennedy style. Nixon couldn't change his sharply receding hairline. At 54, he was too old to do anything but tamp down his short dark hair as flat as possible on his head. Bobby's hair had grown longer every year of the 1960s. Now, at 42, he had the shaggiest hair in the United States Senate. His little brother Ted was the only other senator with as full a head of hair. Bobby's hair was beginning to grow over his ears, rock musician length for the Senate then, and everywhere Bobby spoke outside the Senate chamber, he was treated like a rock star. That's what Nixon and Johnson feared most about Bobby, the way crowds responded to him. They had never seen anything like it in politics. Nixon and Johnson were both old enough to remember the first time anyone saw fans screaming and swooning for Frank Sinatra in the 1940s, before, during, and after every song Sinatra sang. America saw an even more intense version of that fan reaction when the Beatles landed in the United States in 1964. And now, Nixon and Johnson saw a version of it happening to Bobby. Everywhere Bobby went, crowds worked themselves into frenzies. When he spoke, he didn't sound like any senator they had heard before. His voice wasn't stiff and self-conscious. His language wasn't stilted or senatorial. What Bobby's audiences believed they were hearing was a man speaking from the heart about the moral issues of the day: racial discrimination, poverty, the increasingly unpopular war in Vietnam. Johnson and Nixon noticed that there was more political calculation in Bobby's speeches than his audiences realized. Bobby never said what he would do about Vietnam. What mattered to his audiences was that he didn't sound like Johnson, who had escalated the war and was drafting hundreds of thousands of young men into the army and sending tens of thousands of them to their deaths for reasons they couldn't understand or accept in a little country they had never read about in history class. Bobby's adoring audiences believed he would never send them or their friends or their brothers or their cousins or sons or grandsons or boyfriends to die in Vietnam. It could happen to anyone in America then. Anyone could lose a loved one in Vietnam. It was a daily fear for almost everyone in the country. Bobby would stop all that. That's what his audiences heard, even if he didn't exactly say it. Underlying Bobby's speeches was a force we had never seen before in American politics, and something we've never seen since, something Shakespearean. When Bobby stepped up to a microphone, no matter how sunny the day, no matter how wide his smile, he was always framed in tragedy, the personal and national tragedy of the assassination of his older brother, the President of the United States, on November 22, 1963, in Dallas. Bobby's audiences knew his pain because they all felt their own version of that pain on that horrendous day in 1963 that shook the country to the core. In the Kennedys' hometown of Boston, it felt as if the world stopped. I was in St. Brendan's Elementary School in Boston when the nuns got the news that the president had been killed, the first Catholic president, something the older nuns never expected to see. Now they had outlived the 46-year-old Irish Catholic boy who had made them so proud. The Sisters of St. Joseph were the strongest women I knew, but this was too much for them to bear. They simply couldn't carry on. They closed school early and sent us home. We had never seen them cry before. We were all crying when the nuns got us into our lines to march us out to the sidewalk. Everyone we saw was crying. Every driver stopped at every traffic light. Men carrying tool bags were crying. Men carrying briefcases were crying. Boston cops were crying. Subway cars were filled with people crying who had left work early.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.